Get up. Good morning. I am so pumped. Good morning. Hey, Miss Patty. Good morning. Let the people of God say, good morning, Miss Teresa. Good morning. This is the day that the Lord has made, and we shall rejoice and be glad in it. Come on, we come to praise today. We having a praise party today, y'all. Come on, get up. This is the day. This is the day that the Lord has made. Hey, Bonnie. Hey, mother in love. Good morning, Miss Sonia. Come on. I will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord has made. I know y'all know this song. Hey, Miss Donna. Good morning, Gail. Good morning, Taria. Good morning. Hey, Miss Janetta. This is the day that the Lord. Hey, Michelle. Hey, Miss Jazzy. Good morning. This is the day that the Lord has made. Hey, Monique. Good morning, Miss Linda. And be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice. Come on, you gotta get up on this. Come on, good morning. This is the day. Hey, Tim. Good morning that the Lord has made. Come on. I will rejoice. Good morning, Lynette. Hey, Tanya. This is the Lord has made. Hey, Crystal, good morning. Yo, this is a song. Come on. Hey, Rosie, good morning. Come on, somebody. You gotta get up on this. Come on. Good morning, Keita. We having a praise party this morning. Come on. God has been good to you this week. Come on, he woke you up this morning. You gotta get up out your bed. You gotta get up. Come on, I will rejoice. You gotta rejoice just because. I will rejoice. Come on, y'all. You gotta rejoice. I will rejoice. Hey, Tammy. Good morning. Let the people of God say, hey, Miss Beverly. Good morning, Dawana. Good morning, Adia. Come on, y'all. Come on, clap your hands. Even if you lay down, just clap your hands.
The word says, this is the day in Psalm 118,
Verse 24, Miss Brenda, that this is the day that the Lord has made, and we shall rejoice and be glad in it. You got to be glad in it. No matter what you're in, you got to be glad in it. What is it that you're in? I'm telling you right now, I don't care how bad it was last week. I don't care how bad it was this month. You got to be glad in it. Good morning, Miss Sharon. Hey, Shanika, good morning, good morning, good morning. Y'all, I am so excited today. This song got me so hyped. I haven't heard this song in so long. And I was searching and searching for a song for today because I have been so excited all week. God has just been blessing. Good morning, Michelle. Good morning, Bernice. I'm just so thankful. So we have to be thankful and we shall rejoice. How do you rejoice? You got to rejoice with your smile. You got to rejoice with your hands. You got to rejoice with your feet, lady. You got to rejoice shouting. Oh, I shared. You got to rejoice. How do you rejoice? You dance when you rejoice. You get hyped when you rejoice. You tell somebody about God when you rejoice. You got to rejoice and be glad in it. What is your it? I know it might not be good all the time, Winnie. I know it might not be good all the time, Letty. I know it might not be good all the time, Tiffany. But I'm telling you, if you just be glad in it, God will shift that situation. I'm telling you, he will shift it. You just got to be glad in it. I know sometimes people bring you to be a bearer of bad news and they tell you bad things. And sometimes you're just like, oh my God, not today. Every time I turn around, something's going on. But I'm telling you, if you just be glad in it. What is your it? I'm so glad today. I'm glad that he woke me up this morning. I'm glad that he got me in my right mind. I'm glad that I still have my children living with me. I still am glad that I'm in the land of the living. I'm still glad that he still covers me. You got to be glad in it. Somebody don't have their children right now. Somebody don't have a home to live in. Somebody don't have a job. I'm telling you, if you just be glad, somebody just smile right now. Smile, smile, smile. I know you ain't wash your face yet. I know you ain't brush your teeth yet, but just smile. Come on, just smile for me. Come on. Good morning, good morning, good morning. Y'all, yesterday was crazy. Matter of fact, not yesterday. I'm going to rewind to last Monday. Last Sunday, I talked to y'all about complaining. And I was so excited. I was so convicted about me complaining about my car. And some of you guys are on social media already, but some people, a lot of people watch me on YouTube. So I have to give the testimony because everybody that watches me on Sunday morning on Facebook Live does not follow me throughout the week. So I just want to share with you this awesome testimony. When I talk to you guys about complaining about my car, and I was saying how I need a new car. I want a new car. This car getting on my nerves. I was just complaining that I need a bigger car for my children. And when I goes outside, my aunt by here calls me and says, Sheeta, I'm outside. She had Veda and she had her daughter, Bisa. I already have four other children with me. And my aunt baby car seat is so big. I'm like, by here, it's no way that you'll be able to fit that car seat in my car. My little Benz is just too small for the car seat, these four other kids and Veda. I say, won't you trade your keys to me? You go to work with my car and I take your car. Well, I was complaining about not having enough room to take the kids to Betty's Bounce. And here I got a car from her the same day with eight seats. It was eight of us. It was me, Veda, Bisa, Zyla, Harlan, and Bella, Jazz, and Isaac. It was eight of us. She gave me her car, her Benz, which seated eight people. God will give you exactly what you need in this season. He didn't give me a six-seater. He didn't give me a four-seater. He gave me an eight-seater on the same day I was complaining so I could get my kids where I need to go. That was the first blessing. Y'all, I was freaking out. I'm like, oh my God. Then the very next day, the person that gave me the car that I had that I was complaining about, she gave me that car like 2.5 years ago, her and her husband, at the salon, and I was at the A+. I had all the Pampers in my car filled to the top, like I always do, coming from the place where they donate, all the way in Norristown. And I pulled up the A+, and who's sitting there? Miss Angie sitting there in her Benz. in an R350, sitting there, like, Rasheedah, I'm like, hey! I was so excited. I'm like, oh my God, I was just talking about you yesterday. Now, mind you, I have not seen this lady in over 2 years. It literally been over, like, a year and, like eight or nine months. That's how long it's been since I seen her. It's so crazy that when she gave me the car, she hadn't even got her hair done no more after that day. That's how amazing God will be. He will send the angel just for you. This lady been getting her hair done by Sharon for years. But after she gave me the car, she stopped getting her hair done and started getting braids and wigs and never came back. So I hadn't seen her until one day I went to her car dealership, her and her husband, and told them I needed a van for my for feeding the 4,000. Well, she said to me in the parking lot, she said, dude, me and my husband was just talking about you. Do you still need the van or a passenger car for feeding the 4,000 for your ministry? I'm like, come on, Miss Angie, you know I still do. I still got the little bands. I don't have nothing else. This is all I got. She said, girl, my daughter been talking about, she been seeing you riding down Night Street in the car. Let me tell y'all. She said, me and my husband go to the auction all the time. Don't worry about it. We got you. Now, I don't know if we got you, mean they're going to give me another free one or something real inexpensive. But let me tell you something. When she said she got me, I felt like God was sitting on my lap and just pouring out blessings. When somebody say, I got you, what? Come on. I got you. That means don't worry about nothing. You will be fine. I will take care of it. I am telling you, in this season, you got to be ready with hands wide open, waiting for God to give you exactly what you need. He's not going to give you a little bit. He's going to give you exactly what you need in this season. That's why you got to be glad in it. God had to show me that I need to be glad with the little Benz I got, with the little car I got. It's a Honda Civic, but guess what? I call it a Benz. And God showed me two Benzes back to back on Sunday when I'm out here, because she got an EL350, that C8. And then Miss Angie got an R350, that C7. I had that R350 years ago. I had a car like that and got in a bad accident with me and Beta. Let me tell y'all something. God will give you a glimpse of where he's trying to take you and what he's trying to give you. But you got to be glad in it. You have to rejoice in all things. You got to be rejoicing all the time. I'm telling you, then I go to preach for Mount Pleasant Baptist Church. I had to preach yesterday. Saturday morning, I get up, 2:45 in the morning, my phone rings. It's ADT. We have a burglar alarm. Are you coming? I say, yes, I'm coming. I falls back to sleep. The cop called me and says, are you coming? Somebody broke into your salon. I'm like, oh my God, somebody really broke in. I got to get up. So I get up. Now I'm nervous because I'm like, oh my God, somebody breaking in. Who's going to be there with me? I'm like, I calls Dwayne. I'm like, Dwayne, you got to go to the salon with me. I said, I'm afraid. I gets there. He comes with me. I go to the salon. The cops is there. I mean, y'all, this guy literally went inside of my window. The window is so high. I don't know how he climbed up in the window because the cameras didn't show. He had no ladder. He had no chair. He jumped up in my window. How do you hop up in a window? The cop gonna say it was Spider-Man. Y'all, he didn't get nothing. But and because I had my doors with a buzzer on, he couldn't find a way to get out. So he had to climb back out the window. He fell down the window on his face. Listen, I had not went to sleep since 2:45 yesterday. Well, literally like 3:15 that morning because I had wanted to fall asleep. I had to go back to work at 6 o'clock. I didn't leave that salon until 4:15. I had to be to work at 6 a.m. When I left work, I had to complete the people here that I had to do. Then I had to go preach the gospel with the Mount Pleasant Baptist Church women. And then had to go back to work because I rescheduled all my people to later on in the day. When I get there, I was met there by two women. Two women that is always faithful with SGS ministry. Let me tell y'all something. One lady called me. She was like, kept calling me while I was actually preaching. She's like, Rasheedah, I got to meet with you. I want to see you. She comes in and hands me three envelopes, three cards. One of the cards in it, oh my God, I just can't believe it. One of the cards in it had a check for $1,000. The other two cards was for Veda and Zyla. She gave my children money. I'm just so outdone. She gave my children money so that I won't spend the money that she gave me on my children. Then the other young lady called me and said, what do you need?
I was on Zoom. I know you need something. What do you need? She always taking care of me. She always calling, making sure that I'm okay. I said, all I need is a cup of ice from Wawa and some water. She bought me a big bag of ice and a big gigantic thing of water. 24 waters. I mean, Gabe went over and beyond in blessing me. I'm telling you guys one thing, and I got a word for you today. But I'm telling you, when you stretch yourself, when you are doing the mandate of God, when you are doing what God asks you to do and he calls you to do it, God will give you exactly what you need. He will provide for you. With me, I never ever have taken off work to preach the gospel because I have to work. Like, my job is so crucial. When I don't do hair, people are constantly calling. And I said, Mount Pleasant Baptist Church have blessed me so many times in so many ways with my feeding ministry, their evangelist team. They always are constantly pouring in to SGS ministry. And I say, I have to take off to preach the word of God for this ministry because they always take care of me. When you do what God calls you to do, he will provide. Miss Brenda from Mount Pleasant Church said, I know this is your day that you make a lot of money. I know it is, Rasheedah. We're going to take care of you. I said, don't worry about it. I got you. I was able to go back to work and take care of what I had to do. But God sees your efforts. God see you pressing in. God see you not being stagnant and not complaining and not murmuring and doing what's necessary. Even after I got done preaching the gospel, I went back to work. After I went back to work, I actually went and picked up my kids. Then I went and picked up Zyla and my niece. Then I went to a graduation party. I dropped off a card. Then I took my kids to Funplex. I didn't get home till 11 o'clock last night. Your days can be full with God if you ask him just to give you a little bit of strength. I'm not bragging. I'm telling you that you can do all things through Christ that strengthens you. You got to stop making excuses. God will give you the capacity. He will enlarge your territory if you are willing. You got to be a willing vessel. He got to be able to see that you can be used. You got to stop complaining. I'm tired. I don't feel like it. I got too much on my plate. Every time I turn around, something going on. I can't take it. I can't take it no more. This is too much. You got to be glad in it. You got to be glad. I'm telling you that God sees your efforts. Most gracious and eternal Father, we bless your holy and righteous name. I'm just so thankful, God, that you are our Father. I'm so thankful that you love us. I'm so thankful that you see us, that you're omnipresent. You're everywhere at the same time. You know exactly what everyone needs that's on this live today and those that will come back on the replay. Father, you know exactly what it is that we long for. You know our down settings. You know our uprising. You know our heart. You know the thing that we are dealing with. You know our issues, our trials, our tribulations. You know our joy. You know our sadness. You know our peace. God, you know everything about us. But Father, we come to you empty today, ready for our overflow. We're coming empty. So Father, we ask you today to fill us up. Fill us up like never before. Make us the example. Use us in a mighty way. A lot of us might not have a title. We might feel incompetent. We might feel like we're not needed in the kingdom. But Father, show them their purpose. Show them where they belong in the kingdom so that they can receive all that you have in store for them. So Father, I thank you. I honor you and I love you. In Jesus' name we pray with thanksgiving. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight. Oh Lord, my strength and my redeemer. Let the people of God say amen. Amen, amen, amen. I'm so excited. Yes, Lynette, he will expand your territory. Oh my gosh. Territories is expanding. So today, I have a topic today. Our topic today is, you can have it all and keep getting more. I don't never start off with a topic, but today I got a topic. You can have it all and keep getting more. I was studying for the Kingdom Women yesterday, all for the last 3 weeks. And as I was studying in the book of Philippians, I constantly read all the way to the end of the book. Because one thing that I learned, that when you read a scripture, it's good to read before the scripture and to read after the scripture. Don't just read that one verse. Try to read the entire chapter if you have time. And as I was studying, I wasn't too focused on the whole entire chapter of chapter 4. However, the very first, second, and third verse of chapter 4 was what I preached on yesterday. However, when I studied the whole thing, we have touched on Philippians chapter 4 many times. When we studied on the Old Testament and the book of Leviticus about offerings and things of that nature, and in Corinthians. However, I want to touch on today about you can have it all and keep getting more. Now, I'm going to read out of the Message Bible and out of the NIV version. So give me a chance today to be able to read all of it. It's not really long, but I want to touch on the entire chapter of chapter 4. So go to Philippians chapter 4, verses 1 to 23. Philippians chapter 4, verse 1 to 23. I'm going to read out of the Message Bible first, and then I'm going to read out of the NIV version, because I know a lot of us, we all read out of the NIV version normally every single Sunday. So it says Philippians chapter 4, verses 1 to 23. It says, my dear friends, I love you so much. Now, this is Paul writing a letter to the church of the Philippi. And he's writing this letter to just to show them love. This last part of this letter, chapter 4, is the last part of the letter. And the church of Philippi, he loves them because they took care of him while he was in prison. And it says, I love you so much. Now, this is the Message version. I do want the very best for you. You make me feel such joy. Fill me with such pride. Don't waver. Stay on track, steady in God. I urge Euodia and Syntyche to iron out their differences and make up. Now, these were two women that were having the disagreements in the church, but they were very, very intricate. They were evangelists. They were women that were in the church that were really doing, teaching the message of Jesus Christ. And God doesn't want his children holding grudges. And oh, yes. Sisygus, since you're right there to help them work things out, do your best with them. These women work for the message hand in hand with Clement and me and with other veterans. Work as hard as any of us. Remember, their names are also in the book of life. Somebody say, I want my name in the book of life. I'm going to explain to you what the book of life is in 1 second. Celebrate God all day, every day. I mean, revel in him. Make it as clear as you can to all you meet that you're on their side, working with them and not against them. Help them see that the master is about to arrive. He could show up any minute. Don't fret or worry. Instead of worrying, pray. Let petitions and praises shape your words into prayers, letting God know your concerns. Before you know it, a sense of God's wholeness, everything coming together for good, will come and settle you down. It's wonderful what happens when Christ displaces worry at the center of your life. Summing it all up, friends, I say you'll be best by filling your minds and meditating on the things true, noble, reputable, authentic, compelling, gracious, the best, not the worst, the beautiful, not the ugly, things to praise, not things to curse. Put into practice what you learned from me, what you heard and saw and realized. Do that, and God, who makes everything work together, will work you into his most excellent harmonies. I'm glad in God, far happier than you would ever guess. Happy that you're again showing such concern for me. Not that you ever quit praying and thinking about me. You just had no chance to show it. Actually, I don't have a sense of needing anything personally. I've learned by now to be quite content whatever my circumstances. I'm just as happy with little as with much. With much as with little. I found the recipe for being happy, whether full or hungry, hands full or hands empty, whatever I have, wherever I am, I can make it through anything in the one who makes me who I am. I don't mean that your help didn't mean a lot to me. It did. It was a beautiful thing that you came alongside me in my troubles. You Philippians well know, and you can be sure I'll never forget it, that when I first left Macedonia province, venturing out with the message, not one church helped out in the give and take of this work except you. You were the only one. Even while I was in Thessalonica, you helped out. And not only once, but twice. Not that I'm looking for handouts, but I do want you to experience the blessings that issues from generosity. Now I have it all and keep getting more. That's right there is what I wanted you to see. Verse 18. Now I have it all and keep getting more. The gifts you sent with Epaphras were more than enough, like a sweet smelling sacrifice roasted on the altar, filling the air with fragrance, pleasing God to no end. You can be sure that God will take care of everything you need. His generosity exceeds even yours in the glory that pours from Jesus. Our God and Father abounds in glory that just pours out into eternity. Yes. Give our regards to every follower of Jesus you meet. Our friends here say hello. All the Christians here, especially the believers who work in the place, the palace of Caesar, want to be remembered to you. Receive and experience the amazing grace of the Master, Jesus Christ, deep, deep within yourselves. Somebody say amen. Amen. Now, I'm going to read from the NIV version, but I'm going to expound on the verses at this time. Now, I wanted you to see that Paul said, now I have it all and I can keep getting more. That was all the way in verse 18, but he started out in verse 1, letting the women of God know. These were kingdom women. These women contested in the faith. They was willing to do everything they needed to do in the faith to teach other people about Jesus Christ. They were out of Rome, and these women were fighting against each other in the church. They were workers in the church. They were on the choir together, probably. They were ushers together, probably. They were ministers together, probably. They were evangelists together. They were in the same women's ministry. But they were fighting against each other. And before they could have it all and keep getting more, Paul tells them to clean up your problems. That God is not happy with your grudges that you're holding. If you are bitter with your sister in Christ, you have to clean that up. You have to reconcile, because if you want to be in the book of life, you got to get that stuff together. You cannot think that God is going to bless you and you are holding on to grudges. You're holding on to issues that you had with a person, and it's probably been so long and you can't even remember what they have done to you, but you're constantly angry and irritated with this woman or this man that is still doing the same work you're doing. You both love the Lord. You both are excited about telling people about Jesus Christ. But guess what? You're holding a grudge, and that grudge is stopping you from receiving the blessings that God has for you. How can you have it all and keep getting more if you hate your sister that's sitting next to you? Or you can't stand your brother, or you don't speak to your mother, or you don't speak to your aunt, or your sister, or your cousin, or your child for that matter. You cannot have it all if you do not remove the grudge off of your heart. He started chapter 4 with telling them that I am urging you to help them realize that Christ is coming, and he's coming soon. So I'm telling you today that whatever grudge you have on your heart, ask God to help you remove it, and ask that person for forgiveness. And even if they don't forgive you, ask God to forgive you so you can move on. Because sometimes our grudges hold us back. So let's go on. Chapter 4, verse 1. It says, therefore, my brothers and sisters, you whom I love and long for, my joy and crown, stand firm, What does it mean to stand firm? Standing firm means to keep your eyes on Christ. This world is not our home. We live in this world. We're not of this world. We live in this world, but we're not of this world. The Bible says in Philippians chapter 3, verses 20 to 21, it says, Paul says, but our citizenship is in heaven. Our citizenship is not on earth. Even though you got a social security number on earth, your citizenship is in heaven. It says, and we eagerly await a savior from there, the Lord Jesus Christ. Do you understand that your citizenship is not on earth? So you got to stand firm in the faith. You got to continue to be diligent. You got to be consistent. You got to always show up. I told Miss Patty yesterday. Miss Patty was on yesterday when I was preaching with the women of Mount Pleasant Baptist Church. And Miss Patty said, I got on, Rasheedah. I had my pajamas on. Now, she clicked her camera on, not realizing she had her pajamas on, to watch me preach the gospel yesterday. She was on Zoom, right? She wouldn't have came to church with pajamas on. But she was on Zoom, excited to hear the word, comfortable, right? She showed up. She showed up in her pajamas. Miss Donna, I'm reading from the NIV version now. I was reading first from the Message version. Now I'm reading from the NIV version. I'm reading Philippians chapter 1, verses 1 to 23. And when she showed up, she heard them say, we're having a hat and pearl contest. She said, I ran and got my hat because I love this hat and I never had nowhere to wear it. She put the hat on and some pearls and sat in front of her camera. And the lady scrolled through the camera and noticed Miss Patricia. Let me tell you something. If Miss Patty was not there, if she did not show up, she would not have won the contest. Miss Patty won the best hat contest. Why? Because she showed up. The only way you can win in this season, you got to stand firm, you got to be consistent, and you got to show up. And people that show up, they win. Let me tell you, you will win when you show up. You got to stop making excuses. I was tired yesterday. I never went to sleep from 3 o'clock. But I still made it to Chanel's graduation party. I still took my kids out the fun place. I still preached the gospel. I still went to work. You gotta show up to win. You can't think you're gonna win. You know that the lottery even say, you gotta play to win. You can't say, I wanna win a lottery and you don't play. Ain't that right, Peaches? Peaches said, Sheena, I got blessed so much. God been blessing me so much. Look at this. She came and showed me a letter that God has blessed her. Her husband just died, but God is blessing her even in the midst of her husband dying. And she came to the shop yesterday to show me the letters how God is blessing her and her grandchildren. But guess what? You got to show up. You got to be consistent. God will bless you. You can't win if you always complaining. You can't win if you always home. You can't win if you like, oh, I don't feel like getting on. Oh, I'm so busy. I got this to do. I got that to do. Oh, not today. I'll see you later. I know we busy. Everybody's booked and busy. Not just me. I know everybody's booked and busy. But I'm telling you, get unbooked so you can read the book. When you read the book, if you just take 10 minutes per day to feed yourself the gospel of Jesus Christ, God will see your faithfulness even in them 10 minutes. And he will give you exactly what you need. He will tailor make a blessing just for you. But you gotta be eagerly waiting. You gotta be the citizen of heaven, not on earth. Both this earth. You gotta worry about what's going on to get to heaven. What I gotta do to get to heaven? What you gotta do to get to heaven? Come on, Michelle, what you gotta do? We gotta stop saying, I don't know my purpose. I don't know. I don't know what to do. I don't know. What should I be? What should I be doing? Come on with that. You gotta stop it. Let's go on. It says, stand firm in the Lord in this way, dear friends. I plead with you, with Euodia, and I plead with Syntyche, to be of the same mind in the Lord. He said, I plead with you to be of the same mind in the Lord. He's telling them, I want y'all to stop fighting. If you both say you love the Lord, I want you to be of the same mind. Reconcile. Forgive. Come on. You got to forgive her. You got to forgive him. You got to forgive your family members. You got to stop fighting. Forgive. He pleading with them. He's pleading with them before he let them know how awesome God can be in their life. If you just get your life together and stop. It's possible to believe in Christ, but still have problems with people. It's possible that you can have a disagreement with people. It's possible to not like her. It's possible to not like him. It's possible. But I'm telling you that if you're working for the kingdom, you don't want no broken relationships. You want all things to be whole. You don't got to be their friend. You don't got to call them every day. But I'm telling you, you want everything whole. Nothing missing, nothing broken. And that's even in relationships. It says, yes, and I ask you, my true companion, help these women since they have contended at my side in the cause of the gospel. These women was on Paul's side. They was doing everything that was necessary to teach the gospel. Paul said, y'all was by my side. Y'all was doing this thing before I got locked up. So what happened? Come on, get that thing together. Shift yourself back in order. It says, along with Clement. Clement was a Roman. And he was another person that was higher up in the kingdom. He was also teaching the word of God. It says, and the rest of my co-workers whose names are in the book of life. Let's go to Revelations chapter 20, verses 11 to 15. I want to talk about the book of life. We never talked about the book of life, y'all. Let's go to Revelations chapter 20, verses 11 to 15. That's the last book of the Bible. Revelation chapter 20, verse 11 to 15. And it says, I'm in the NIV version. Then I saw a great white throne and him who was seated on it. The earth and the heavens fled from his presence, and there was no place for them. And I saw the dead, great and small, standing before the throne, and books were open. Oh my gosh! The books were open. Another book was open, which is the book of life. Now, when we're on the judgment seat, we all will be judged individually. I don't care what family you were born into. I don't care if you were poor, if you were rich. You will be judged according to the works you have done in this world. We all will be judged individually. It says the dead were judged according to what they had done, as recorded in the books. Everything you do, everything you say will be recorded in the book of life. I'm going to say that one more time for those in the back. Everything you do, everything you say will be recorded in the book of life. You cannot escape it. What you have done before, whether you ask God for forgiveness, repented, it is in the book of life. Because of his bloodshed, you are forgiven on earth, but you will be judged for the things you have done in this life. And guess what? Because you did not know prior to today, you are now accountable. Everything. Somebody say everything. Everything that you do, everything that you have done, past, present, and future, until the day you close your eyes and die, you will be judged according. Not according to what your mother did, not according to what your husband did, not according to what your kids did, not according to what your wife did, not according to what your boss said to you, not according to what the people did to you at the down the street. It's according to how you responded. You got to check your response. I was told by my mother that everything don't require a response. And this is why. Because your response will be judged. It goes on to say, the dead were judged according to what they had done as recorded in the books. Verse 13, the sea gave up the dead that were in it. And death and Hades, which is hell, gave up the dead that were in them. Now, those that died and went to hell at this particular time, they were even given up to be judged. And each person was judged according to what they had done. It says each person. I don't care if you're a preacher. I don't care if you're a minister. I don't care if you feed the homeless. I don't care if you volunteer. I don't care if you've been in church all your life. I don't care if you preach. I don't care. Each person was judged and will be judged. It then goes on to say in verse 14, then death and hell were thrown into the lake of fire. The lake of fire is the second death. Oh my God, I don't want to go to the lake of fire. Who want to burn forever? Anyone whose name was not found written in the book of life was thrown into the lake of fire. This is why it is our job to save our loved ones, to save our family members, to tell people about Jesus Christ, to not keep it all to yourself. This is why it's necessary that you share the gospel, that you share the lives. When you get on SGS, you tell somebody, if they don't have Facebook, tell them to go on YouTube. You got to share the gospel, because those that name is not written in the book of life, they will go to hell. Yes, your loved ones that don't believe in Jesus Christ, that say, I know God loves me, and he loves me too, but I ain't going to church, I don't believe in God, all that. I believe in this person, I believe in Buddha, I believe in this, I believe in that. They're going to hell. But it's your fault if you don't teach them about Christ. It's our job as disciples to teach the gospel. Paul not coming back to do it. Clement not coming back to do it. Eonia ain't coming back to do it. It's your job as a disciple to teach about Jesus Christ, so they won't go to hell. Eonia and Syntyche was actually, their names were in the book of life because they were saved. They did their work. They did what they were supposed to do. They were appointed to preach the gospel, and they did just that. And their names were in the book of life. But guess what? Them not speaking to each other, them having disagreements, that is in the book of life. God is going to judge them for them not speaking to each other, for them having a disagreement. That issue is in the book of life. And Paul said, get that together, even though your name is in the book of life, because you did what you were supposed to do as your mandate, but you got to get that together so when he judge you, he can say, I seen that you turned it around. Come on, somebody. It's only A, B, and C, 1, 2, 3. It ain't that hard. I know you want to call me and say, Sheeta, but you don't know. You don't know how they treated me. Sheeta, you don't know how they did me. Sheeta, you don't know they did me dirty. I know you want to call me and tell me that, but I'm telling you that if you want your judgment to be right, you got to change the situation. You got to change that thing. It's your job to change it. You are on this live every Sunday. You are consistent in the word. You hear the word. Whether you do it or not, you hearing it. I don't care if you cooking breakfast while you listening to me. I don't care if you washing clothes at the laundromat like Sheen do. I don't care what you're doing. You hear the word, and now you are accountable. Let's go on, because I got a lot to do. Verse 4, it says, rejoice in the Lord always. How do you rejoice in the Lord always when stuff is wrong and stuff is going on and my husband died and my family died and I'm just so sad and, you know, my job laid me off and my unemployment don't look right and this ain't right and this ain't right. I know it's hard to rejoice always, but the Bible says in Psalm 118 verse 24, this is the day that the Lord has made and we shall rejoice and be glad in it. This day is not your day. God has given you another day to rejoice. He didn't give it to you to be sad and to be waiting for a pity party and crying all the time. He gave you this day to be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord has made exactly for you. And you had to rejoice in it. Get excited about it. Be happy that God gave you another day. I know it ain't gonna feel good, but you gotta do it. It says, I will say it again. Rejoice. He came back with it. Like, I'm gonna say it one more time. Again, rejoice. Let your gentleness and be evident to all. Are you gentle, Miss Beverly? Are you gentle to all? Are you honest to say I'm gentle to all? A lot of us are not. We're not gentle to all. But I'm telling you that Paul said, let your gentleness be evident to all. How can it be evident if you always got your face turned up? You always talking about somebody. Every time you turn around, you got something negative to say. Every time somebody hit by, I hear you talking, they hear you cursing. How is your gentleness evident when somebody asks you for something, you quick to say no? You got a reason. It got to be evident to all. The Lord is near. Oh my gosh. The Lord is near. Let's go back to Revelations. I want to show you that he's near. And he's coming soon. Revelation chapter 22, verse 7. The Lord said, look, I am coming soon. What? That's not John saying that. That was the Lord saying, I am coming soon. Blessed is the one who keeps the words of the prophecy written in this scroll. Verse 12. Let's go jump to verse 12. It says, Revelation 22, verse 12. Look, I am coming soon. You know, you better look now. You hear me? Listen. Look, I am coming soon. My reward is with me. The reward you get on earth don't mean a thing to God. His reward is with him. That's at judgment. And I will give to each person according to what they have done. I am the Alpha and Omega, the first and the last, the beginning and the end. He said, I am it. Everything you need will come from me. But he's coming soon. So check yourself. Let's go on. Verse 6. Philippians chapter 4, verse 6. Do not be anxious about anything. A lot of us have anxiety. You know, I just had real bad anxiety about a platform that I was in. And I was losing all this weight. I was like, oh my God, what am I doing? This is crazy. And my anxiety was so high. And God said, don't be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, you cannot worry about every little thing. You got to stop worrying and pray. The minute you start worrying, drop on your knees. I don't care where you at. The minute you start worrying, drop on your knees and start praying. Or sit in your car and just start praying. Telling God exactly what you have and the issues that you're going through. With thanksgiving, start your prayer off with thanking God for what he has already done. Even though it might look bad, thank him for what he has already done. Some people are on this live so excited and so glad for what he's done. They don't have no bad days right now. They're so glad. And that's amazing. Because you can just keep thanking him and thanking him and thanking him for all that he has done. It said, with thanksgiving, present your request to God. Be thankful when you're asking for requests. Don't just constantly be begging, but thank him for what he's already done. Then give him your request. You're able to ask for anything from your Father. He is your Abba. He can give you exactly what you need. It says, and the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. I want to talk about the peace that surpasses all understanding. Because true peace is not found in positive thinking. True peace is not found when you hear a motivational speaker. True peace is not the absence of conflict. We will have conflict. True peace is not in good feelings. I got a massage, so I feel good now. I'm in peace. That's not true peace. True peace comes from knowing that God is in control. I want that to resonate inside of you. That's true peace. That God is in control. Our citizenship in Christ's kingdom is sure. Our destiny is set. And we have victory over our sins. That lets you know that God is in control. So let God's peace guard your heart against anxiety and worry. Amen. Amen. It says, finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true. Now you got to program your mind to live like this. This ain't easy. Verse 8 ain't easy. Everybody ain't going to walk around living like this. But you got to program your mind. Like you program your phone to do right. You program that smartphone to do right. You got to program your mind to literally, literally do this. It says, finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. It's so hard to keep your mind focused on good things. However, it says, whatever you have learned or received or heard from me or seen in me, put it into practice, and the God of peace will be with you. You got to practice these things. It ain't just going to happen. I'm not telling you that you're supposed to be perfect. We're made in the image and the likeness of Christ, but he had to die for everything that we're going through. That stuff that we're going through is already on the cross, but he wants you to put it into practice. Paul said, put it into practice. Practice makes perfect. We are perfect people in Christ's eyes because of the blood shed. God don't see our sins. God don't see our letdowns and our sadness. He don't see that. He see us as pure and lovely and righteous because of the blood shed on the cross. So you have to put it into practice and stop gossiping. Stop having stuff negative to say all the time. Stop calling people always with your negativity. Stop being so angry. Stop always having something bad to say about somebody. Stop it. Choose to talk with love, with peace, things that are praiseworthy. It's not bragging, but you got to talk about the things that's good. Like I always try to give y'all a good and encouraging story in the beginning of our lives. That's just to encourage you that life is good. Everything ain't gonna always be perfect, but life is good. Let's go on. It says in verse 10, I rejoiced. Now this is Paul still talking to the church of Philippi. He said, I rejoiced greatly in the Lord that at last you renewed your concern for me. Now, Paul at this time is in prison. He's in chains. And because he's in prison, he knows that he's still doing his mandate. He's still trying everything he can. And he wrote this letter to the church of Philippi, and Epaphras delivered the letter to them. And while he was delivering the letter, he made sure that he let them know that I love you guys so much because you was concerned about me. Just like Peaches was concerned about me yesterday. She asked me, what do I need? She brought me some ice and some water. She was concerned about me after I got done preaching. Even though we weren't in the church, she was like an armor bearer yesterday. And I don't need to be eating ice because I have an iron deficiency and I need to take my iron pills because I'm being disobedient from what the doctor told me. But I needed some ice yesterday and she went and got me a big bag of ice. She was concerned about me. And that's what Paul is saying, that I am concerned. I am excited and rejoiced that you have now renewed your concern for me. Even though I'm not out at the churches, I'm not at the synagogues teaching the word of God, I'm still in prison and you still are concerned about me. I don't know who's on here that their loved ones is incarcerated and they've been there for a while. Don't leave them for dead. Be concerned about them. Send them Calvin Sarah. Send a letter every now and then. Call them. Or maybe let them call you. But we have to be concerned about those that are in chains. It goes on to say, indeed, you were concerned, but you had no opportunity to show it. They were concerned about Paul, but they didn't have a chance to show it because he was in chains. So it says, I'm not saying this because I am in need, for I have learned to be content whatever the situation, whatever the circumstance. He has learned to be content with his circumstance. Paul was able to run freely. He went from here, there, everywhere, preaching the gospel. Now he is in chains. He's in jail. That's like somebody that's in the Wesley house. And they have been put out of where they live. And they don't have nowhere to go with their children and their husband. And they are now put in the Wesley house. But they make the best of it. And they become content in their situation. They become content in their circumstance. They are homeless. But they make it their home and they do what is necessary until they are able to leave. That's what Paul is saying, that I am content in my situation. I am content with what I am in. It says, I know what it is to be in need. We all know what it is to be in need because of the pandemic. Some of us did not have a job during the pandemic, like myself. I found out that I was not essential. I was stuck at home and I did not have no money coming in. I truly found out what it meant to be content in every situation, to not have no money coming in, to not have no food coming in, having to figure it all out. I know what it is to be in need. Paul said, I know. He also said, I know what it is to have plenty. I went from no money in my hand, no money coming in for 4.5 months, to now so much money. Oh my God. I gotta show you. I know what it is to have none, and I know what it is to have plenty. I have learned the secret of being content in any and every situation, whether well fed. I know what it is. They have a lot of food. They have all kinds of cereal on my refrigerator, or none. I did not have no food on my refrigerator during the pandemic. I had to go to feed the 4,000, to feed the hungry, and feed myself with me and my children. Because I did not have no money coming into my business and I had to rely on God. I went from one box of cereal from feeding the 4,000 to more than enough now. I know what it is to be well fed or hungry and still preach the gospel. I preached the whole pandemic knowing that I had to figure it out the next day. Let me tell you something. God will show you a glimpse of how your life can be. But in the midst of that, you got to still do what he called you to do. It says, whether living in plenty or in want. I was able to go away on a trip every 3 months with no problem. Just go away. Now I got a schedule to go away. Because I was living in plenty before. Doing hair all the time, all day, all night. Now, because of the coronavirus, I have to schedule my appointments accordingly. And I can't work the way I used to work because of the coronavirus. So my income has been cut in half. So I went from plenty. Oh my God. I'm trying to make it plain for somebody on here. That you have to learn to live in plenty or in want. He said, whether living in plenty or in want. I know what I want, but I know what I have. I can do all things through him who gives me strength. We love to say that. We love to quote Philippians 4:13. But when you quote that thing, you got to know what it feels like to truly be hungry. You got to know what it feels like to truly be in need. You got to know what it feels like to really be in a place where you can abound and abase in God. That thing is serious. To know when you don't have nowhere to lay your head. To don't know where the next meal is going to come from. To not know exactly how you're going to feed your kids. Or how you're going to pay your rent. Or how you're going to be able to do anything. Because you're all tapped out. And God said, oh my God, he will give you exactly, oh my gosh, what you need. He will give it back to you full circle. But you got to remember where it came from. Verse 14, it says, yes, it was good of you to share in my troubles. Paul's in trouble at this time. He's in trouble. He said, I'm in trouble. Let's go to Philippians chapter 1, verse 7. Why was he in trouble? They were sharing with him in trouble. Philippians chapter 1, verse 7. It says, it is right for me to feel this way about all of you, since I have you in my heart. And whether I am in chains or defending and confirming the gospel, all of you share in God's grace with me. Paul loved the Philippians because they shared in his issues. They shared in his suffering. Paul had joy even in his suffering. But the Philippians, they shared in his suffering with him. Are you sharing in somebody's suffering? Somebody right in your family is suffering and you won't even share the goodness that God has given you to help them out. You will let them drown in their debt. You will let them drown in their situation. You will not even let them live with you. Because you're like, I ain't letting them live with me, them and their kids. They get on my nerves. You will let them literally find somewhere else to go, knowing you are their family member. I can't stay there because we already out of time. Let's go on. Moreover, as you Philippians know, in the early days of your acquaintance with the gospel, when I set out for Macedonia, not one church share with me in the matter of giving and receiving. Is that something that when Paul was preaching the gospel, not one church gave him offering. Not one church decided to take care of him but the Philippians. Let's go to 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 7 and 9. Real quick. 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 7 and 9. Now, the church of Corinth, I'm in the first Corinthians, 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 7 and 9. It says, was it a sin for me to lower myself in order to elevate you by preaching the gospel of God to you free of charge? Now, Paul is saying, I'm preaching the gospel free of charge. I'm not asking you for a dollar. But do I have to lower who I am to elevate you? I know that you act like you want to give me an offering. But if you choose to, you can. But if not, I'm still going to preach the gospel. This is the church of Corinth when he wrote this letter. He says, I robbed other churches by receiving support from them so as to serve you. He said, I'm using the money that other churches gave me to go here and there to preach the gospel to you, and you don't even give an offering. You don't even give a thanks offering. You rather me preach the gospel knowing that I need help, knowing I need things, knowing I need food and shelter, but you choose to let me preach the gospel for free, don't even choose to take up an offer for me, and I have to use that same offering to help others. When you give to SGS Ministry, you give to help the feeding the 4,000. You help me allow other people to be fed, that their kids can be fed so they don't have to worry about how they're going to feed their children or feed themselves. You don't give it to me. You give it to me to help the brother of the kingdom. It ain't about me. Paul said, I'm robbing myself I'm robbing other churches to take care of your church. I'm here writing a letter for your church, taking care of the church of Corinth, and you ain't gave me nothing. It says, and when I was with you and needed something, I was not a burden to anyone, For the brothers who came from Macedonia supplied what I needed. And I have kept myself from being a burden to you in any way and will continue to do so. Paul said, I'm going to keep preaching whether you like it or not. And I'm not going to be a burden on you. I'm going to keep preaching the gospel just like myself. You will never catch me begging nobody for money to preach the gospel. You will see my face on Facebook Live on Sunday morning at 7 o'clock, whether I get paid or not, whether you give an offering or not. My mandate is to preach the gospel. My mandate is not to ask for money. That's not my mandate to say, you got $100, 10 people get $100, stand in line, 10 people get $5, stand in line. That's not my mandate. My mandate is to teach the word like Paul. I don't care if you give me anything. The Jews knew what it was to give an offering. In Leviticus chapter 7, verse 12 to 15. Let's go to Leviticus chapter 7. Leviticus chapter 7, verse 12 to 15. The Jews knew what it was to give a thanks offering. Leviticus chapter 7. But the Romans and the Greeks, they understood what offerings was, but they did not give sacrificial offerings on the altar. Because Romans and Greeks that were Christians, they did not offer up sacrifices to the Ark of the Covenant. They did not burn offerings and burn animals. When they fell in love with God, they loved God. They did not have all these rituals and all these laws like the Jews did. However, when Paul was talking to the church of Corinth, they knew the laws. They knew the laws of Moses. So they knew what it was to give a sacrificial offering. And Paul was talking to them, the church of Corinth. He's telling them that you know what to do, but you choose not to do it. But it's okay because I'm still going to preach the gospel whether you give me anything or not. It goes on to say, Leviticus chapter 7, verse 12. I'm going to start at verse 11. These are the regulations for the fellowship offering anyone may present to the Lord. When you give an offering, you are giving an offering to the Lord. It did not say a fellowship offering given to the pastor or the priest. Is given to the Lord. Even though you hand it to the priest, even though you hand it to the pastor, even though you hand it to the minister or the reverend, is given unto the Lord. When that young lady gave me that check yesterday for $1,000, she did not give that check to me. She gave it unto the Lord. Oh, come on. I know you were talking about, I ain't giving that church all that money. They always begging. They always ask for money. But I'm telling you, when you give to the kingdom, you are furthering the kingdom of God and you will receive a reward for it. Oh my God. Tell them, mother in love, you a trustee. You count the cash every Sunday. Tell them that they're giving to the Lord. They're not giving it to you. It says, if they offer it as an expression of thankfulness, then along with this thank offering, they are to offer thick loaves made without yeast and with olive oil mixed in. Thin loaves made without yeast and brushed with oil, and thick loaves of the finest flour well kneaded with oil mixed in. Along with their fellowship offering of thanksgiving, they are to present an offering with thick loaves of bread made with yeast. They are to bring one of each kind as an offering, a contribution to the Lord. It belongs to the priest who splashes the blood of the fellowship offering against the altar. The priest is the one who that goes behind the veil for the Holy of Holies when he prays to God. And he would cover the atonement of all their sins. He would cover all their sins on the Day of Atonement. So this offering goes to the priest. It says the meat of their fellowship offering of thanksgiving must be eaten on the day it is offered. They must leave none of it till morning. I want to read the footnotes of what this verse just meant. It said the fellowship offering was divided into three kinds according to the purpose. Thanksgiving offering, a vow offering, and a free will offering. This is where the churches get the free will offering from. It says a thanksgiving offering was appropriate whenever one wished to show thanks to God. As when recovering from a serious illness or surviving a dangerous calamity. A vow offering was given in fulfillment of a vow. The free will offering, however, needed no special occasion or reason. When you give an offering to God, it's no reason behind it. It's no special occasion. You're just giving to God. Just like that young lady came to my shop and just gave me a check. It was for no reason. She just said, I appreciate you. So when you give to God, not to the minister, not to the pastor, not to the church, when you give to God, 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verses 6 to 15. I'm not going to read it all, but I'm going to read some of it right now. It says, remember this. This is Paul talking to the Corinthians. He says, whoever sows sparingly, whoever gives a little bit, will also reap sparingly, will also receive a little bit. And whoever sows generously, whoever gives a lot, will also reap a lot. Each of you should give what you have decided in your heart to give. Not reluctantly, not unwilling with hesitation, or under compulsion, not being forced. Don't be forced to give money. When they say give an extra $100, give an extra $50, give an extra $20, but they first say it's a free will offering. How did it become a free will offering, but now you're asking for extra money begging? That's not God. I'm going to sit right here for 1 second. I was just put in a situation where I was in a situation where I preached with someone and they did that to me. They like, we need to ask for extra $100 per person. And it blew my mind because everything was paid for. Everything was covered. And at the end of the service, they say we need an extra $100 from everybody. That's not God. Because if it's a free will, they gave what they had decided in their hearts to give. Not with hesitation and not under compulsion. We should not be forced to give anything. You can still give even when they ask for extra. If you got extra and God pricked your heart to do it, then do it. But don't feel forced that you won't be blessed if you don't. For God loves a cheerful giver. And give it with happiness, with gladness. Don't give it with an attitude like, oh, here they go begging again. Let me just give you my $20. Don't give it because you're killing the spirit in which you were supposed to give it. Now you have stopped your blessing. It said, and God is able to bless you abundantly so that in all things, at all times, having all that you need, you will abound in every good work. I'm gonna go to verse 10. Now he who supplies seed to the sower, who is he? Now God who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food will also supply and increase your store of seed and will enlarge your harvest of your righteousness. You will be enriched in every way so that you can be generous on every occasion. And through your generosity, you will result in thanksgiving to God. Oh my God. This service, I got to read the rest. I can't stop right here. This service, this giving service, this free will offering is a service. When you give to God, that is part of the service. It is a service unto God. It says this service, just like you serve as an usher, you serve on the choir, you serve as a minister, you serve at the feeding of 4,000, you serve as a volunteer. When you give your money to God, it's a service. This service that you perform is not only supplying the needs of the Lord's people of the service, but it is also overflowing in many expressions of thanks to God. Oh my God, not to the pastor, but to God. Because of the service by which you have proved yourself, everybody will be tested by their cash. You will be tested by your money, because money is currency. Money shows energy. Money shows your commitment. Do you know that God measures your commitment by your money? I know you want to feel like God, like, no, you don't have to have a lot. No, you're okay. I know you love me. I know you just barely have enough. But our God is a prosperous God. He gives you exactly what you need. He don't make his children poor. You choose to be poor. He makes us as rich. Rich. Overflowing with blessings. It says, by this service, you have proved yourselves. In Malachi, he said, I will test you by your tithes and offering. And he will open up the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing that you will not have room enough to receive. It goes on to say, others will praise God for the obedience that accompanies your confession of the gospel of Christ and for your generosity in sharing with them and with everyone else. And in their prayers for you, their hearts will go out to you because of the surpassing grace God has given them, has given you. Thanks be to God for his indescribable gift. Do you know why Ellen and Oprah is rich and just constantly overflowing with blessings? Because they're always giving. I don't know if Oprah is a Christian, but it's the law of currency. Currency flows. When it goes out, it comes back. The wealthy stay wealthy because they give. You will never stay wealthy if your hands stay closed. In order to receive, you have to give. Paul told the Corinthians that you can sow as little as you want. But guess what? What you give is what you're going to get. I know you didn't give me when I was preaching the gospel. I know you barely wanted to give me when I was teaching you. But guess what? The Philippians did. And let's see what else happened. I know we over time, y'all, but I got to finish this because God has been just so awesome to us and so amazing that I can't even give all the testimonies that God has been sharing with me through his children. But the word gives it. It says, yes, it was good of you to share in my troubles. I'm in Philippians chapter 4, verse 14. Moreover, as you Philippians know, in the early days of your acquaintance with the gospel, when I set out for Macedonia, not one church shared with me in the matter of giving and receiving except you only. I know a lot of you have not given to SGS ministry. A lot of you have. You have given your time. You have given your energy. You have given to the ministry. Whenever I ask for donations for turkeys, for whatever I ask for, you guys always are there. A lot of you have not. And it's okay, because when God gives you the unction to do that, when God gives you the unction and you can do it with gladness, that's when you do it. Do you understand me? Don't do it because I say give, give, give. I want you to do it when your heart is right. The Philippians' hearts was right. And that's when they gave. It says, for even when I was in Thessalonica, you sent me aid more than once when I was in need. You ladies and gentlemen have given to the cause of feeding the 4,000 more than once. You have given to the cause of the gospel. Whatever I need, you are always there. It says, not that I desire your gifts. Let me tell you something. This ministry will be going on whether you help or not. I don't desire your gifts. Right, Reverend Rasheedah Lee don't need your money. God will give me exactly what I need. He will provide. He give you the provision. When you have a vision, he provides for you. What I desire is that more be credited to your account. It wasn't the gifts that Paul was worried about. It was the love that the Philippians have gave Paul. It wasn't the money. It's not about the money. It's about the love that you show. It's about how you show up when I ask you. It says, now I have received full payment and have more than enough. I can have it all and keep getting more. All because you share with me in the gospel. All because you give to SGS ministry. I can have it all and keep getting more. And because you share, God will give you all and you will keep getting more. When you give to the kingdom, He will give you more than you can ask for. Do you hear me? You can have it all and keep getting more. Paul said, I received full payment and have more than enough. Oh my God. I am amply supplied. Why was he amply supplied? Because they gave to him. None, now that I have received from Epaphras the gifts you sent. Now he's still in prison, and the Philippians gave to Epaphras to give to Paul. And Paul said, now that I have received from Epaphras the gifts you sent, they are a fragrant offering, an acceptable sacrifice pleasing to God. He didn't say it was pleasing to me. He said it was pleasing to God. He received the gifts and he's amply supplied. He has more than enough. He has an overflow. He said it was a fragrant offering. Just like when they burnt offering on the altar in the Ark of the Covenant, it was a fragrant offering to the nostrils of God. And it was like an incense to God. Well, that's what Paul is saying, that when you gave your offering, it was a sweet smelling savor to the nostrils of God when you gave your offering. And it says it was an acceptable sacrifice. He like, I know it was a sacrifice. I know you gave out of what you didn't have, but it was an acceptable sacrifice. I can receive the sacrifice because I know you gave it from your heart. I know you gave it because you really didn't have it, but you gave even when you didn't. He said it was pleasing to God, and my God will meet all your needs according to the riches of his glory in Christ Jesus. Now, a lot of people say this scripture, and God will meet all my needs according to his riches and glory. But I'm going to tell you something. If you don't pay your tithes, if you don't give offering, you will not be met with everything that you need. Because Paul said to the Philippians, their needs will be met by God because they met his needs. Come on. Stop thinking God's going to meet all your needs and you don't even give to the church. You don't give to the kingdom. You don't give nothing but lip service. All you do is talk. Oh, God is good all the time. God is good. I'm too blessed to be stressed. Oh, I love the Lord all my heart and all my soul. All you do is talk, but you don't give nothing to the kingdom. And all your needs will not be met because you don't give. If you don't pay your tithes and offering to the church, you might as well forget about it. You know why? Because you hear the gospel. You know the word of God. And because you know the word of God, you have to do what the word says. And God will then meet all your needs according to the riches of his glory in Christ Jesus. He has more than enough to give you. He can give you more, an overflow. But you got to be willing to give first. Oh my God. I'm going to just sit right there for 5 seconds. Because I know some of y'all like, I'm going to just give $5. I'm going to just give $1. Knowing you made $100 and now you can give 10, give 10%. You have to give to the church where you're getting fed. Even if you don't go to church and you're with this ministry, you're supposed to give. When you get a word, you're supposed to plant seed on that word. Don't get a word and don't plant seed on it because you want that word to grow in your life. You got to plant seed. He gives seed to the sower. You know why you broke? Because you ain't getting no seed from God because you don't give seed to people that don't plant. He gives seed to people that plant. You'll never see a gardener on their knees with their stake in their hand and don't have no seed to put in the ground. What is they tooling the ground for if they ain't got no seed? You have to sow in order to receive. Verse 20, and now we're done. To our God and Father be glory forever and ever. Amen. You can have it all and keep getting more. You don't have to be broke. You don't have to have a little bit. You don't have to have, oh my God, I don't have it. Oh my God, what I'm going to do? I don't know what I'm going to do tomorrow. I don't know what I'm going to do. You don't have to live like that. You don't have to live like that. You can have it all and keep getting more. I'm going to be done right now. You can have it all and keep getting more. More love, more joy, more peace, more self-control, more healing, more power, more anointing, more faith, more contentment, more money, more properties, more land, more houses, more businesses. You can have it all. You can have a solid relationship. You can have a committed marriage. You can have a smile every single day. You can have peace in your walls and peace in your borders. You can have it all. You can have all your bills paid with credit, with an 800 credit score. You can have your kids cooperating. You can have your children not being incarcerated. You can have your family members loving you. You can have it all. You can have the best job, but you have to be willing to give. Most gracious and eternal Father, we bless your holy and righteous name. Father, I know I went over today, but Father, I ask you that even though this word went over, that your blessings will flow over unto your children, that they will be able to see the hand of God on their life, that they will never doubt you again, that they will believe that you give grace and mercy morning by morning and evening by evening, that you are always there no matter what the situation is. Father, we thank you that we will remove our issues with our sisters in Christ and our brothers in Christ. We will take the stain off our hearts. We will not hold grudges against our sister and brother in Christ. Father, let our names be in the book of life, that when you judge us, you will judge us according to our deeds, according to what we have done on earth, according to our good works. Father, we ask you that we repent for our sins. We thank you that your blood covers a multitude of sins. Father, we thank you that you cover us in all that we have done. Forgive us for our speech. Forgive us for our attitudes. Forgive us for our gossiping. Forgive us for the things that we have done that's not pleasing to your sight. Forgive us for every word, thought, and deed that did not line up with your word. Father, we love you today. We honor you today. We lift you up. Father, show us our purpose. Show those that don't know their mandate. Show it to them, God, and give them the opportunity and expand their territory so that they can do what is necessary in the kingdom. Father, I ask you today to give seed to the sower. All those that are on this side that are consistent, Father, give them seed so they can sow. What is seed? Seed is money. Give them money so they can put it in the ground, so they can give it to the church. Father, I ask you to let us know what it is to be well fed and hungry. Father, let us see what it is to be in need and in want. Let us be content in every situation. Father, I thank you. I love you. I honor you today. Father, there is somebody that's on this live today that do not know you in a part of their sins. I ask you today, if you don't know Jesus Christ in a part of your sins, I'm telling you, he is amazing. He is marvelous. He's a miracle worker. He's a promise keeper. He is the lily of the valley. He's a bright and morning star. He's a will in every will. He is a bridge over troubled water. He is an ever-present help. He is the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. He's the bread of life. He is the resurrection. He is the peace of God. He is everything that you need. If you don't know him today, I ask you to repeat after me. Lord Jesus, I believe you are the Son of God, and I believe you came to earth, and I believe you died on the cross for me, and I believe you shed your blood for me, and I believe you rose from the dead. Right now, I come to you, Lord Jesus, because I am a sinner. Forgive my sins. Cleanse me with your blood. Make me clean, and I will be clean. Come into my heart. Save my soul. I no longer belong to Satan. I belong to you. I am forever yours, and I am now saved. I'm so excited. Somebody say amen, 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 amen. I'm so thankful to you. I'm so gracious. And I just love you guys so much. I thank you so much because I know that some of you have been learning so much. I know that some of you have been learning so much about God. And that you want more from God. And I'm telling you, if you want more, you got to do more. You got to study more. You got to get up in the morning and force yourself to read the word. Or if you get up too early, do it at night. But give God your time. Give God your heart. Give God your love. And he will give you everything that you need. I'm telling you, God gives me over and above what I can even ask or think, according to his riches and glory. Because I try to be as consistent as I can. I know that you don't know right now what your mandate is or what your purpose is. But I'm telling you, I didn't know what mine was either. You know, I found a flyer the other day of me when I had a birthday party when I turned 30. And it was just so funny how I was so different just 15 years ago that I was, truly a whoremongler. Like doing everything possible to have fun and to enjoy God. To enjoy the works of the devil. I was just excited. And when I seen that flyer, it just took me all the way back to me going to church but still doing what I wanted to do. And we can do what we want to do because God gives us a choice to do what we want to do. But I'm telling you today, I urge you to make the choice to live in God and not die. Live in purpose. Live in joy. Live in peace. Give God your whole heart. Believe me, I enjoyed everything I was doing. That sin felt good. But the feeling I have now is so amazing. It's a different kind of love. It's a different kind of happiness. It's a different kind of joy. It's a different kind of gladness. I'm excited to wake up to tell somebody how good God has been. So I urge you today, like Paul urged Euodia and Syntyche, to get their disagreements together. I urge you today to give God your whole heart. I love y'all. I thank you so much for being consistent. If you don't do nothing else in this life, be consistent. I love you. God bless you. Have a wonderful and awesome Sunday. And tell somebody that Jesus loves them. And also share this live. Share this live with somebody. Don't just keep it to yourself. Because God is so amazing. He loves you. I'm just overwhelmed. I'm overwhelmed with love and joy and peace. And I love y'all. So I thank you. I thank you so much for being consistent. I'll see y'all next Sunday at 7 a.m. Yeah. Yeah, we worship you. God bless you. Donna, how do you pay your offerings? I have PayPal at this time. All I have is PayPal. It's paypal.me/SGS Ministry. I'll put it in the chat. I don't have Cash App anymore because my Cash App kept getting hacked. But I'm actually going to... I am going to sign up for Giblify so that you can give with your credit cards at all times. But right now I have PayPal, and I'm able to receive an offering on PayPal at this time for the ministry. So I thank you so much for your offerings. And also, if you are not on my updates, I want you to text SGS to the number 474747 so you can get updates on a consistent basis. That's SGS to 474747. I'm gonna write in the chat. So this is what you put in the chat. You put in, you text SGS to the phone number 474747. And then if you want to share this word with somebody, tell them to go on YouTube if they don't have Facebook, And my YouTube is Reverend Rasheedah Lee. I'm going to put it up. There you go. And they can receive the word every single day, whatever time of the day that they need to receive it. God bless you. I love you. Thank you so much for being consistent.